It is said that a leader has the vision and conviction that a dream can be achieved. He was one such man. A reform-minded clergyman who not only called for change, but worked tirelessly to improve the lives of those he served. He was admired and highly respected by many, not only for his courage, as he spoke for justice and reconciliation, in defense of the poor and oppressed, but also for his unequaled humility. This is the story of Bishop Alexander Kipsang Muge. Alexander Kipsang Muge was born sometime in March 1948 in Kimgoror village of Mosop Division, Nandi District, in Rift Valley Province. As a child, Alexander yearned to know the meaning of things around him. When his father discovered his thirst for knowledge, he enrolled him in the Africa Inland Church Primary School at Tangaratwet. On completing his Standard 4 Common Entrance Examination in 1962, he went on to study at the Anglican Mission School, where he passed the Kenya Primary Education Examination.
During our childhood, Muge was younger than some of us. But he was clever than those who were older than him. He used to be, know more about. He could even drive the older generation and told them, let us do this and this.
Years later, Muge met Herma. They would marry and go on to have 4 children, 2 daughters and 2 sons.
Nilipenda kwa ajili ya kasi yake, furaha yake, na vile alikuwa na kaa na watu. Alikuwa ni mtu wa kufuta watu sana.
After working as an untrained teacher in his home area, Muge joined the Paramilitary General Service Unit, GSU, as a corporal. He served in the Shifter Wars and was awarded a Northeastern Campaign Medal for bravery. From the front line, he was transferred to the crack GSU Wrecker Company in the GSU headquarters in Ruiru. Now in his early 20s, he was living fast and loose, but he would have an encounter that would change his life forever. On October 25th, 1970, he attended a service at the St. Michael's and All Angels Church in Ruiru.
By that time, we had not tried to go to church. And then one time, we decided to go to church. Then I think from there, he converted into Christianity. And then he asked me whether I can left the GSU. So he said I want to left the GSU and join the church ministry.
In 1973, he decided to resign from his work as a soldier and begin studies at St. Philip's Maseno Bible School. In 1976, he was ordained a priest at St. Stephen's Church, Jogoo Road, in Nairobi. This made him the first and only Kalenjin priest in the Nairobi diocese. In 1979, Muge went to pursue theological studies at the London Bible School in Britain. While in London, his eloquence earned him many good friends, and he became secretary to a Pan-African student body. He graduated with a Bachelor of Arts in Divinity from the London Bible School and returned to Kenya in June of 1982. He rejoined the Diocese of Nairobi, and on July 1st, he was appointed Assistant Provost of All Saints Cathedral. After serving at the All Saints Cathedral for 11 months, Muge would make history in 1983 when he was appointed as the first bishop of the new Eldoret Diocese, which had been newly created from the division of the Nakuru Diocese. At only 35 years of age, he became the first Kalenjin bishop of the Anglican Church. He started the diocese from nothing. At first, his study room doubled as an office. Later, after some renovations, the garage and a timber house served as an office. There were only 2 vehicles in the entire diocese, 18 parishes, and 2 missionary areas with a total of 23 clergy. Muge's first priority was evangelism, and his initiatives enabled the diocese to undergo tremendous growth. He personally participated in youth camps, evangelistic missions, rallies, and other church activities. Because of his love and care for the youth, he was appointed provincial chairman of the Kenya Anglican Youth Organization, a position he held until his death.
Alifanya kazi alikuwa akiamuka saa 9 ya usiku. Baita tae mwingine wanafika ofisini yeye ameendelea na kazi. Kwa hivyo alikuwa ni mtu wa bidii sana, hakulekea kwa kazi yake. Aliendelea akijitahidi kabisa. Na kwa muda ya miaka 7 nafikiri alifanya kazi ambaye wengine wangefanya kazi miaka 20.
In his office at Eldoret, he was working with people from various tribes, whether they are Kikuyus or Luyas or Luos or whatever. He managed to get people of all tribes to work together.
He was very organized and a manager par excellence. He had everybody knew what was doing. He motivated his staff. They were very, very devoted and determined. And there was a team spirit because he treated all the workers as very important.
His diligence and hard work bore fruit, and the diocese grew to 28 parishes, 6 missionary areas, and 36 clergy. His diocesan staff also grew from 2, Muge and his secretary, to 140. By then, the diocese owned 36 motor vehicles and 9 motorcycles. In the community, he would not only call for reforms, but work to create change as well. He organized funding and initiated a number of projects to improve the lives of the people in his diocese.
He was passionate about assisting in building a more just Kenya, a more just society, bridging the gap between the rich and the poor, really guaranteeing every Kenyan a minimum quality of life.
Muge's main projects were based on sustainable development. Muge was not against the handouts of giving people relief food during drought. So he developed projects especially for women and for the young people, building dispensaries, agricultural programs for young people for training. He was also a very practical person. He was not just a person who was preaching fiery sermons at the pulpit and not translating what he was preaching into something tangible that could be seen. And I think that is what made him very unique, because he was both charismatic and also a very practical pastoral leader.
In the 1980s, he was responsible for the construction of a water project that would supply clean water to the residents of Kimworor location, as well as the construction of the first hospital in the area. But despite all the work he would perform in his vast diocese, he would always make time for his family and those who would call on him for his help.
He liked people, whatever kind of people, whether they are people very lowly, and the people loved him dearly. The other thing was family. I remember there are times they would have debate with his wife, Helma, and he is very, you know, nice and a jocular as they are debating, and he would not be forceful. And they could debate for 30 minutes and they are laughing. And when you look at his children, he loved them and they loved him.
Muge's greatest battles, however, would be fought in another arena. From his days as the assistant provost at All Saints Cathedral, he began using the pulpit as a platform to call for reforms in the government. During his 11 months at the All Saints Cathedral, he would grab national headlines with his sermons. Sunday after Sunday, he would fearlessly chastise those in the seats of power for their part in the scandals that were rocking the country, at times with those same people in attendance.
1980 was probably the most difficult decade that we had politically in this country.
In 1982, there was an attempted coup. In this attempted coup, the perception changed, and Moi knew that there are forces that are ready to remove him, even by use of gun.
The President Moi who took over in 78 was not the Moi of 83. And I think the change and the repression started with the attempted coup. I think that's when he sort of lost it and went berserk in terms of wanting to pursue any enemy. I suspect to ensure that that sort of thing never happened again.
At that time, the freedom that we are enjoying today would have been unfathomable. There was a lot of state anarchy, and anybody who dared to voice an opinion against the state openly was either detained or killed.
Those were some of the darkest hours. And Bishop Muge was eloquent, was outspoken about these issues.
Bishop Muge saw himself as a protector of the people. And it was in this treacherous climate that Muge would choose to make his unwavering stand for social justice. A few months after starting the Eldred Diocese, Muge would begin speaking out about inequalities in Mo subdivision of Nandi District and would champion the plight of the poor.
Mbunge wa area hii ambaye ni alikuwa the late Mheshimiwa Meta. Na kuna wale wengine marafiki zake walikuwa nachukua maendeleo yenye Bishop Muge amelete kama ni atui ya kisiasa. Walikuwa nafikiria ya kwamba pengine huyu Bishop Muge atasimama akihitaji kiti cha Mosop. Ndio chanzo ya maneno mengi ilikuwa wanatarajia ya kwamba pengine Muge atakuwa MP wa area hii. Lakini Muge hakukuwa na hiyo tarajio. Alikuwa anapambana tu kuona alete maendeleo afikie kila mtu.
Kitu alichukia zaidi ni mambo ya elections. Tulipoingia 1983, hata elections ilikuwa inafanyika. Sasa ikawa kuna rigging. Hapo ndio walianza kutofautiana sana kwa mambo ya rigging. Na wanasiasa walipojua huyu ni mtu ambaye hapendi mambo ya uhalifu na mambo ya ufisadi, ndio hapo walianza kupitana.
When in 1986, the ruling party, KANU, announced that the queue voting system would replace the secret ballot in both party and general elections, Muge would vehemently oppose the move. Together with others such as Bishop David Gitari of Mount Kenya East, Bishop Henry Okulu of Maseno, and Presbyterian Church of East Africa's Reverend Timothy Njoya, Muge would speak out against what he saw was an affront to the democratic process and the sanctity of the vote.
For the first time we saw a process of election that had not been witnessed anywhere in any form of democracy, where you queue to elect your political leaders. But I think the most interesting bit was that in most of the cases, people with the shorter queues won elections as opposed to people with longer queues. And secondly, I also often say there was a new way of understanding arithmetics where numbers did not have to necessarily go from 1, 2, 3, 4. A returning officer would insinuate, for whatever reason, that from 3 you would effectively go to 50 and declare you a winner.
This queuing system, it was introduced to remove outspoken members of parliament. You know, they were arguing that because it is daytime when you go to queue, you can see the longer queue. And I went to watch, I could see the longer queue. But in the evening, when you open the radio, the shorter queue wins, the longer queue loses.
In 88, people were able, ordinary people, even the ones who do not know how to read or write, they were able to see rigging. The short queue would win because people would go and queue behind the popular candidate. Then the DC would announce that the person whose queue was very short had won. These are the issues that Muge, Bishop Gitari, and others spoke very, very strongly about. And it mobilized people, the Kenyan people, everywhere.
This opposition angered KANU politicians, who chastised Muge and threatened him with disciplinary action. He, however, dismissed the threats, saying, "I am prepared for public execution, if that is the wish of KANU, or they can bury me alive. Those, in fact, are the options I am giving them."
Bishop Muge, atamuke maneno tu ovyo ovyo. Atakuwa ametafuta ukweli ya maneno ambaye atakayeenda kusema. Kwa hivyo, kila wakati akisema neno, wanasiasa wanajua, ametambua ukweli. Na ukweli imechulikana. Kwa hivyo, watarudi kutulisa yeye, kusema please, tupereke hii maneno pole pole.
Bishop Muge would not relent, and in April 1987, at the height of the political tension, he caused a storm with his criticism of the Kenya human rights and political situation, comparing it to that of apartheid South Africa. He said it was pointless for Kenyans to protest against injustices in South Africa when there were worse injustices at home. The retaliation was swift. At a KANU rally in Eldoret, attended by Kalenjin KANU bigwigs, led by Cabinet Minister Justice Ole Tipis, Muge was accused of being an agent of the apartheid South African government. Nominated MP Karioki Chotara asked the bishop to pack up and move to South Africa with his family. At another rally in Kericho, Isaac Salat claimed that Kenya would be better off with Muge dead.
It takes a lot of courage for one to take up a position and to criticize a president who is from his own ethnic community, because you're then seen as a traitor, you see. So it was that much more difficult for Bishop Muge than it was for us, because he was seen as an outcast, as a betrayer.
And because he was seen as one who was not supporting the regime, many of them rose against him.
But Muge's criticisms were not only reserved for the politicians. Addressing a 1985 National Council of Churches of Kenya seminar, he said, "To the best of my knowledge, the church as an institution has nothing to lecture our nation about, because all the evils that eat our nation, such as tribalism, favoritism, nepotism, and other isms, have found true shape in the NCCK. Muge felt strongly that the church had to be beyond reproach in order for it to maintain its moral authority.
Muge was in a dilemma in most cases, because he had to criticize both his colleagues within the church and also the system, which was headed by somebody from his own community. So he was really toying the line, and that required courage and wisdom for him to be able to speak vehemently with conviction.
In June 1988, Muge brought to light the famine situation in the Kachileba area of West Pokot. He organized a relief operation and even dared President Daniel Arap Moi to visit the area. Moi did visit and said that there was no substance to Muge's claim. An independent investigation ordered by the government came to the same conclusion. For the first time, the president publicly reprimanded Muge and termed his allegations as lies. In August 1990, Muge would cause another big stir when he appeared before the Saitoti-led committee hearing into the queue voting and one-party system. Muge claimed that a clique of ministers had isolated the president by driving a wedge between him and the people. He likened it to the situation in Ghana under the rule of President Kwame Nkrumah, who Muge said had been so misinformed by the clique around him on the need for reforms that he was eventually brought down. Muge's statement brought a furious reaction from the president and those around him. Moi accused Muge of misjudging the general feeling of Kenyans and their relation with him. In parliament, Nandi MPs led by Ezekiel Banyatunyi called for Muge's detention. And at a rally in Busia, Peter Okondo, the then Minister for Labour, went as far as to tell Muge not to set foot in Busia, saying that if he did, he would not return alive. Muge ignored the warning, as he had many others before it, and on August 14, 1990, set off to Busia.
That early morning, Bishop Muge came to where I used to stay in a guest house at 5 a.m. And I was surprised why Bishop has come so early. Then he said that we are going to a town near the border.
Basi ilipofika saa moja, amekuwa tayari, ndio Peda Mbuku akaingia hapa nyumbani, tukaomba pamoja, alafu wakaondoka wakaenda.
Something was telling me inside me, something terrible could happen.
They started from Eldoret in a convoy of cars belonging to the diocese. And as I was telling you, my friend Bidan Bogwa was in that convoy, a very good friend of Muge. So they went to Busia, and there was a huge crowd waiting for them at our church there.
He was to make what turned out to be a triumphant entry. The visit and the service he conducted only a few hours before his death exemplified his love for his detractors. He was to tell the big crowd that came to welcome him, "The Bible teaches us, love your enemy as you love yourself. I love Mr. Okondo and bear no hatred or malice." And finally he prayed for him.
And then at lunchtime they went to Ngoff Hotel in Kakamega, where they had lunch, and then they started their journey back home.
There was a trailer that looked like it's just deliberately organized and is moving very slowly up the hill. It looked like it started when we were near to move up the hill. So when there is a trailer, so all of us were kind of on a line now and close together. Then a vehicle, a canter, came
from the opposite and is coming downhill with all full lights on.
The oncoming truck is said to have suddenly increased its speed, with its headlights on as it approached the late bishop's car. It deliberately swerved directly towards the bishop's car, making it impossible for him to escape at that high speed. It swerved from the left side of the road to the right side, as one drives from Eldoret to Busia. In other words, from this analysis, the truck was intelligently geared towards a definite collision with the late bishop's car.
So I went to his car, which is now mangled, and he was trying to gasp for air himself. And he was saying, "It is done, it is done, it is done." And then he went silent and he died.
At only 42 years of age, the visionary leader of the Eldoret Diocese was gone. There were calls for a public inquest into Muge's death, but the driver of the milk truck that caused the accident had already been arraigned in court on the charge of causing death by reckless driving. The Attorney General, Matthews Guy Muli, said that the criminal case against the driver took precedence over any inquest. The driver was eventually convicted and sentenced to 7 years in prison, but died after serving only five. Peter Okondo became the object of public anger and criticism and was forced to resign on 20th August 1990 for his comments in the days leading up to Muge's death. He would thereby become the first ever cabinet minister in Kenya's history to resign due to public outcry. Fittingly, Muge was laid to rest on the grounds of the St. Matthew's Church in Eldoret, forever being a part of the diocese he endeavored to build.
In the world of political reforms, you would not find a greater soul with a greater conviction as you would find in Muge.
Muge was a compassionate person and he loved to serve humanity. And those are lessons that as young people, we need to learn. Muge gave us a gift of democracy. And we need to use that gift in a very wise manner. We need to elect leaders who are responsible and be responsible leaders when we are elected.
Alipenda nchi yake sana. Wale wanaitwa patriot. Bishop alikuwa patriot kabisa.
Muge was a fiercely honest person who spoke his heart, regardless of what people would interpret what he said.
And that courage and that passion for justice in the country is that what makes Muge a great man.
Bishop akumbukwe kupikania haki ya nchi. Kwa ajili hiyo alipikania kabisa. Kuona kila mtu ametendewa haki. Kuona kila mtu ametendewa ukweli. Na viongozi wote watende na wafuate ukweli. Na waseme ukweli.
I think the best way to remember him is to promote now realization of what he lived for and died for.